cooking?
Nothing.
How are you?
Nothing.
Huh?
Nothing. Sit down.
Alright.
Over here. Oh. Oh. I almost went to sleep waiting for you. What's that? Oh, camera? Oh.
My name is Orville Klein. I'm about to take you on a journey through the wonderful world of the marimba. We present to you the sociological perception of hybrid music. However, unless one truly lives every aspect of the topic, many hidden cultures can surface. This results in a constantly skewed view from every angle. The purpose of this film is to present information gathered through a wealth of resources focusing on the tune percussion aspects of hybrid music.
Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the President of the United States.
Every night, and they make music you would not believe. Not a false note, one finishing his solo and dropping into background support, then the other, all adding inspiration until they get going too strong to quit. Is really composition on the spot. And it is a collective thing, the most beautiful example of men working together to be seen in public today. Otis Ferguson, The New Republic.
Thank you.
Orleans in the 1890s stimulated the interest of John Calhoun Deegan, who in 1880 had begun making orchestra bells for friends in symphonies and bands. He soon applied the scientific tuning principles and mechanical skills which he had developed to the marimba and xylophone.
At the Mustard Division of the Conselmer Corporation in LaGrange, Illinois. I've briefly been the plant manager here since April of 1994.
Can you give a brief history of the company?
The actual forming of the Musser Company probably was in 1948 with Claire Omar Musser. Started it in Ravenswood Avenue in Chicago. Then in turn was bought out by a gentleman by the name of Dick Richardson with the Musser Catching Division formulated here, which in turn was bought up by Ludwig Industries, which in turn was bought up by Selmer, which in turn was reorganized and put together as the Steinway Musical Group, which in turn again was merged and reorganized with Kahn Corporation to the Kahn Selmer Corporation.
And it's affiliated with Steinway?
Yes, we're part of the Steinway Musical Holding Group.
Begins in Central America in Belize, formerly British Honduras. Far back in the hinterlands from the port of Belize are the forests, where as few as one in 250 trees is the botanical species Delbergia stevensonii that provides the high-density tropical rosewood needed for Deegan instruments. He searched tropical hardwoods to find the most desirable material for his instruments. This one variety of Honduras rosewood, cut only from certain sides of the coastal mountain range with proper soil, water, and growing elevation, is the standard which he adopted for Deegan instruments. Deegan's agent in Belize today, who received his degree from University of Edinburgh in forestry and was formerly National Minister of Forests for British Honduras, handpicks the logs for Deegan instruments. They are selected for large size, uniform straight grain, and roundness at a considerable cost premium. This selection represents less than one-third of the total harvest of logs because this species typically produces a convoluted and irregular trunk, and large trees are the least accessible. The woodshop foreman personally selects from each board the sections from which a suitable bar can be made. Again, about 60% of the wood is rejected for poor grain, low density, cracks, knots, or other imperfections. This operation, called voicing, along with joining and molding, shrinks the yield of the boards by roughly another 40%.
Consider the width of the keys you're going to make. Let's see, this stuff is 8 inches wide, so you'll be able to get 2-3 inch wide keys out of that and still have a little excess on the edge for sanding or evening things out when it's not completely screened.
Here is from Africa. It's from the Senegal tribe in Burkina Faso, West Africa. And the special thing about this marimba is the pentatonic scale. And the pentatonic scale is the five notes, the five black notes of the piano. You have the black notes and the white notes. And this is just the black notes, and that's called pentatonic. But where did that pentatonic scale come from? Well, we have to go thousands of years before the Africans got a hold of the marimba, and that's in China and Asia and all those ancient areas there. They found a stone marimba, two stones in Vietnam, and with those two stones, And as you can imagine, if you found some stones, how would you know that's a part of a marimba? Well, they just happened to find two round stones next to the two slabs of stones, and there were worn spots on the two slabs and also on the two round stones. So they knew that that was a part of a musical instrument. Of course, there was just two notes. There might have been more, but where were the other notes? They were just lucky enough to find the two. And also in the Mayan civilization, they had some stone marimbas. And I've been in that area and asked people about them, and I've heard about them, but I wanted to see for myself. And a lot of the people there didn't know what I was talking about. But I was in Mexico City listening to a performance of a group that plays authentic instruments from the Aztec Indians and from the Mayan Indians, and they had a stone marimba, and I'll play just a part of it, and we're having problems. You know how you usually have problems with these type of things? Well, we've already started off with one, and it's going to be probably 1 or 2 seconds of this stone marimba, so you have to look up here or else you're going to miss it.
What's all this stuff
here?
These are the buzzers?
Doing the vibrating is made out of the plastic that comes on a cigarette wrapper. And there you have a choice too. There are a number of different materials that will buzz. And that makes the buzzing sound that you hear. Forces that buzzer to vibrate too. Now this buzzing, to the Western ear, it sounds like distortion, and it takes a little bit of getting used to. When I first heard Boca Marimba playing, I was checking the band out to see if I'd be interested in playing with them. And after I heard their concert, I said, you know, I'd be really interested in playing with you guys, and I've done a little work in instrument construction. I think I can help you get rid of that buzzing sound. And they thought that was pretty funny, because they had gone to considerable lengths to get that buzzing sound, and here I was trying to help them get rid of it. The buzzing sound is a very important part of this music. It's what makes these marimbas different from orchestral marimbas that you may be familiar with. And one kind of exciting thing that you might find in playing this music is that sooner or later you'll be in a group of instrument playing with a group of people playing marimbas, and you'll hear what sounds like a human voice singing. And you'll look around and see who's singing, you'll notice that there is no one singing. What happens is that because of the buzzing of the instruments, when you have a number of them playing together, whenever you have two notes played at the same time, there's something called a difference tone produced, which is a note that is, if say for example one note is 440 cycles per second, and then somebody else plays another note that's 540 cycles per second, you'll hear the difference tone. The difference between those tones is 100 cycles per second. You will be able to hear something called a difference tone produced at 100 cycles per second.
Try something different from time to time. And the song is called The Difference in Pitch.
If, say, for example, one note is 440 cycles per second, and then somebody else plays another note that's 540 cycles per second, you'll hear the difference tone. The difference between those tones is 100 cycles per second. You will be able to hear something called a difference tone produced at 100 cycles per second. So if you get seven different instruments playing at the same time, some of them playing chords, two notes at once, you're going to hear a lot of difference tones. And when you add the dimension of the buzzer, it gives a quality of a human voice. So you'll hear something that sounds like singing going on in the background. And that's one of the reasons that the buzzers are used in this music. Sound very much like a human voice, and it's very compelling, beautiful sound to hear. So that's one of the reasons to go ahead and build buzzers for your instrument. A lot of people will build buzzers just because, well, it's the next step in the process, and they don't necessarily understand why they're doing it or necessarily appreciate the buzzing sound that they make. But that's a couple of things to think about. It makes the instrument louder, it adds a new dimension to the sound quality, and it can add some magical elements to
the beginning of the marimba. The most important part, let's remember, is the tectonic scale. Now between the trade, between the Africans, the Europeans, and the Asians, they were bringing most of all the scale into the African area, the pentatonic scale. And in Asia, they used the slabs of wood like this, but they put them over a box. And what the Africans did for the first time now was they added a gourd resonator on the bottom of each note. And that's an African invention. And also another very important invention is on the bottom of each gourd, we put beeswax, and it's very sticky, and we put it around the hole. And then on top of the hole, we put pig intestine skin or any type of membrane, animal intestine membrane. And you can use bat's wings because on the bottom it's transparent. And the hardest thing to do is to find spider's eggs, and you mix the eggs with the spider's web, and then it's like a liquid, like an omelet type thing. And you let it dry out, and it dries out into a paper, and you put that over the resonator hole, and that makes the membrane. And what happens is that whenever you hit a note, that membrane vibrates, because the air is trying to escape out of the nearest exit, and it's trying to escape out of that membrane, and it makes it buzz. And it's exactly the same principle as a kazoo. You know how you hum into the kazoo? And the little paper vibrates. Well, that's wax. It looks like wax paper, but it's goat intestines.
They don't care much about the cocoon. They just play on it. And in Scandinavia, they play the same modern music that they play in America, Scandinavia or Central Europe. But for instance, your charts are a little bit different than ours, as far as the stretching.
Well, Deegan was on a 4/4.
I mean, I'm using the same stretching, you use it a little differently. Mm-hmm. You do have it, because I have it most of the chart.
Yeah, we have a stretch tuning process.
I know, I have it. And it works different than anybody else uses. For instance, I have it here in the house, two sets of chimes made in Holland by Adams. They were sold to Cleveland Orchestra and Cleveland Institute, mm-hmm. each on a set. And Richard Wehner was complaining about the tuning all the way, so they sent them to me, and they were out of tune. So I tuned them to the Deegan specs, and bingo.
So you just go by the Deegan specs?
Oh yeah, I'm still using them.
Even if it comes...
I will never change it.
Even if the manufacturer has different specs, you will always
change it. I will never change it.
You will always change it.
I've been using them, no, I change it. When I tune Mozart instruments, for instance, right bingo, I adjust it to the Deegan specs. Jinkos, Lidys, Adams, Yamahas, Bourgeros, Corys, Mahler and Marimba ones, Mahler Tex. All the instruments I tune in the summer. In the whole summer I tune about between 100, 120, 150 sets of keys. And they were all tuned to the Deegan specs.
I'm not sure, but I don't think they use too much of the straws like the ones that we use in here. They go more for the
ear.
The hearing, for my ear. Yeah, but not this kind. Some strings here in the United States. Not even at the private parties. In Mexico, you go to a special place and then you go and hire. They ask you what kind of a band you want. They want with the accordion, they want with marimba, and things like that. And then you go and hire them. You tell them that you want a marimba player, two or three players in one marimba, or whatever, you know. But they ask you what kind of band you want.
Does that type of thing impress the master at all?
What's that?
Quadruple tuning.
You know, what's the matter? You're trying to take my pictures again?
No, I'm taping this city.
There's nothing down here.
Approximately from very, very start to the finish, there's approximately 600 hours of labor in a marimba.
One marimba.
One marimba.
This company has got foresight, but they got plenty of foreskins, but no foresight.
Which really isn't manufacturing marimbas, they just do their tuning of bars in the United States. And I've been to Yamaha, which is another company that does not actually do any production in the United States, but they're a distributor.
You have a marimba different.
He's building it piece by piece, or you have it that's produced in a, call it a modern factory, using modern manufacturing techniques. Is different than the American manufacturing philosophy, culturally and statistically.
Social perception of the marimba.
I would think a marimba player would be one who's social, maybe not social, but whose status in the playing field might be a little bit higher than another person playing another instrument.
Anthrax, or at least the exposure to the spores, and now we have learned just moments ago out of Boca Raton, Florida, that five more employees of the tabloid publishing company American Media have tested positive for exposure to anthrax. Total number now in that company connected to that particular building are 8 people. Today, there were still roughly 150 such swab tests that still had results pending. So even though the total number now is 8, that number could conceivably rise, although we don't have any indication of that fact. All of this comes on the very same day that the state of Nevada reports that, yes, an envelope there that was sent to the Reno offices of Microsoft has tested positive for the bacteria in that envelope of anthrax, though nobody has come down with exposure to anthrax. And Mayor Rudy Giuliani announced in New York that they have discovered the envelope that has tested positive for anthrax that was sent to NBC Nightly News. Tom Brokaw, we're going to have more on these developments at the top of the show.
This has been an informative journey through the sociological perception of hybrid music, focusing on tuned percussion.
you've learned today a couple of things. How to beat Yamaha at their own business. Right?
Right.
Yeah.
What's the other thing?
I don't remember.
Yeah.